It's a pleasure to be here today. I've had an opportunity to attend at least one other lecture here with this group, and it's a very noted and wonderful series, and does me honor personally to be invited to do something here. So we're there. Now, if any of you came under the illusion that you were going to see Omar Sharif coming out of the desert and emerging, you know, out of that vast nothingness and coming before the cameras, I'm going to make a disclaimer right here from the top. This is a little more mundane than that. So what we'll be talking about. So I'm starting out with the recognition that the Lahav Research Project, which is the project Ed noted we have been working on for 40 years now, it was organized in the 70s. In order to study a very small archaeological site in the southern part of Israel. It's located adjacent to Kibbutz Lahav. Tell Halif is at the intersection of three geomorphological zones, the Negev Desert on the bottom of the slide here, the so-called Shefela, which is the agricultural area of the main agricultural area of the country, and then the Judean Hill country, which is in red on this slide. It had three objectives. First of all, to examine the stratigraphic history of the mound at Tell Halif. Second, to investigate the environment around the site to see what its resource base was. And then third, to study its modern ethnographic remains. The excavations in fields on and around the Tell produced a series of 17 stratigraphic phases dating from the 4th millennium BC all the way up until present times. Meanwhile, the regional survey explored the area around the site along the ridge of hills, the uplift hills of limestone that formed the boundary toward the Judean Judean hills, and then flanked the valley systems on each side of these hills, where there was good agricultural opportunity and good water sources. And this welcoming agrarian setting is what attracted ancient people to this little site just north of Beersheba a little bit. It also gave impetus to the Jewish settlers who established Kibbutz Lahav in the 1950s, actually in 1952. The ethnographic investigations, about which we will focus on here today, were stimulated by the interest of a number of the members of our main staff, including Karen Seger and Betty Shuttler, and these initiatives that they were interested in doing were warmly encouraged by members of the kibbutz, who themselves had long history of studying their own environment and the peoples that they were living with. This research focused on the remains at Khirbet Khuweilifeh. If you don't know, the word Khirbet is the Arabic word for ruins, and it used to reference places where you can still see a little bit of standing walls as opposed to, you know, just stuff that's hidden underground. So Khirbet Khuweilifeh, which gave the name to the Tell Khuweilifeh in the Arabic, converted to Tell Halif by the Israelis as they settled in on the site. So the focus was on this settlement that had existed in the early 20th century out on the eastern terrace that runs off from the foot of the Tell off to the east into the fields, the surrounding valley system. From the earliest days, the kibbutz settlers, the people that built the kibbutz back in the early 1950s, they were an Air Force group that came, like so many of the groups that formed kibbutzim during that time. When they finished their service, they joined together to engage in an enterprise and to settle in an area. And so this particular group was associated with the Air Force. And so this interest that they had in the ethnography and the archaeology of their site kind of made them interested in collecting materials. They first had a small on-site museum at the kibbutz, and then subsequently they were collecting money to develop a center for regional folklore studies. And they named it in honor of an Air Force attaché, actually, that had been in the United States and was killed in Washington. So they, in honor of his memorializing him, they named it the Joe Alone Center. And the Joe Alone Center went through a number of phases. And ultimately, they also then drew in a collection of Bedouin artifacts from the Negev Desert area and created a Bedouin museum. So this complex was established with the members of the kibbutz, and of course it was parallel to our interests in excavation and so forth, so we were very much involved with them during that time. Unfortunately or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, the regional council in these more recent years has decided that this whole complex should now become a high school for Bedouin youth. And so it's now being used for that purpose. The settlement history at Khirbet Khuweilifeh begins in the late 1800s when the area was claimed by the Ramadine Bedouin of the Tiaha Confederation. There'll be a test on that later, so remember those two names. Their origins are reported to be from somewhere in southeastern Jordan that they came over into the area in the 1800s. The Bedouin, as we know, consider themselves to be the true Arabs, living as tent dwellers and being herders of sheep and goats, primarily other cattle, moving with the seasons to the best pasturage sites. They are not agriculturalists. So, from the earliest time in history, we know that these Bedouin of the desert were not really all that distant from settled lands. In fact, they were almost always adjacent to settled lands. And they would, the nomads, the Bedouin, interact all time through history with the people who were doing agriculture in the settled lands. And so what they produced, they would be selling their milk, their animal products, leather goods that they manufactured from the desert, also trade goods that they were trafficking in, spices, we know that for it was a big trade, jewels, special beads, and sometimes metal materials. And these they would exchange with the villagers in the settled areas for agricultural products like, you know, grain, fruit, vegetables. And they would also sometimes exchange for manufactured goods, which you would certainly expect. Pottery was one of those things that they would collect, and various tools and other things that you can imagine. At the genesis of the Khuweilifeh settlement, it served as an emporium, as a marketplace for the exchange of these goods between the Bedouin, claimed the area, and the village Arabs who lived in the Hebron Hills very close by. Some of these fellaheen, these village Arabs, established their seasonal homes at the site of Khuweilifeh, settling in caves, natural caves that were dotted across the landscape. And they would develop them and make them into their seasonal homes while they were doing their business there. In the years after World War I, some of these seasonal cave dwellers became permanent residents while they still understood themselves to be using the lands controlled or owned, understood that they were clients of the Bedouin in these cases. Among these was a family named the Al-Kayaki family, who, as we learned and we'll talk about a little more later, became residents in one of the cave complexes, actually Cave Complex A, at Khuweilifeh in somewhere in the early 1930s. So then, 1976, another group of Bedouin moved into the area and set up their shop. This was our first season, the Lahav Research Project, and we did indeed look like Bedouin at that point. We took advantage of all the junk that the kibbutz was putting in their salvage dump, as they called it, and we made up our equipment and our tents and all kinds of stuff out of their cast-offs. This is a view of the site in 1947. This is before the kibbutz had settled on the area and before the forestation, which the Israelis initiated after the State of Israel in the area got underway. So we kind of, if you'll excuse, we call this our naked lady. You can see the mound in the lower part of the area. And then up on the top of the picture next to Khirbet Khuweilifeh there, you can see the caves. There must have been, you know, some hundreds of these caves scattered around that had been occupied. In the 1970s, when we returned to the site to do our work, even with the development of 20 years of the kibbutz at the site, there remained several dozen of these cave complexes, these cave areas that you could still identify. We could still see that they were still there. 10 of these, which we labeled A to F, and you can see them here and just above the tell on the map. These were the best preserved of the sites, and so we did some deliberate investigation of all of these 10 as part of the project. But, of course, can't do everything, so we had to decide we would concentrate on at least one of these for a more special effort. And this was what we call Cave Complex A, which is located conveniently to us at the foot of the major excavation cut that we were making up the slope of the mound and not too far from our dig camp. So, you know, convenience and so forth was involved in our selection of it, but it was also one of the best preserved of the sites. The excavations in Cave Complex A were conducted during the 1976 and 1977 field seasons under the supervision of Karen Seger. Karen spearheaded both the excavation work and the related ethnographic interviewing enterprise. She passed away 2 years ago, 3 years now, in 2014, just as we were completing our major publication work on this material. This is now in press. The book and this presentation, therefore, I dedicate in her memory. In 1976, the architectural plan of this Cave Complex A was laid out by our architect, draftsman, Mark Laystrup. And as you look at this plan, you can see that the cave chambers, nine of them, they're labeled A to F on the plan. Two of these, chamber A with its satellites rooms B, C, and D, these were primarily used, it seemed, for domestic purposes, whereas chamber E, with its satellite cave F there, as you see on the lower part of the plan, these were seemingly the stable area, the area where animals were kept for the people that lived in this. Access to these chambers was through a very carefully constructed entryway. It extended slightly out beyond the drip line of the edge of the cave, and we found from other cave complexes in the area investigating, they seem to have covered over these open areas with just brush. That is the what we come to know of as the crown of thorns bush, or what they call Sarcopterium spinosa. Again, that'll be on the test too. It's a nettle kind of a material, and it was good for shade and easy to assemble, and it kind of lasts forever I don't think anybody out here in the desert knows of any plants that might do that same thing, but actually the environments are really very similar in southern Israel and in Tucson. Okay, so outside of the cave area, there was a large courtyard, and in the middle of the courtyard there was a depression, which at first we thought might be a cistern, but after doing some interviewing and getting some information, we found out that it wasn't really a cistern after all. It actually had just been a storage area where the people in the complex would store tibben, which is chopped up straw, and other animal fodder. So it was just a kind of a storage bin in the out in the middle of the open area. This whole area out here, of course, was bedrock, and the courtyard itself was settled down into the into a kind of a cave area with some walls of the bedrock on the sides, and then they built walls around to make the rest of the complex secure. We want to look at inside of the courtyard. There were two enclosure areas, as we called them. There was the enclosure two, which you see here, is a kind of a squarish room. This was off to the right side of the entryway, and then enclosure three, which is at the actually at the entrance, and it has, as you'll see, a niche. Both of these, we discovered through interview, were used as arisha. Now, an arish is a outdoor living room, bedroom. And these are frequently seen, as in this picture, on the roof of the houses in the villages in the surrounding area. They were kind of open-air patio areas that were used during the warmer seasons as sleeping rooms for the people living in the house. Enclosure three had this niche in it, which we're sure had a zir standing in it. A zir is a water pot. And it, so when people came into the complex and through the entryway, they would have some water for drinking either for the family or for guests immediately. And then you see on the other side here is one of those black broken water pots, which was found on the floor just inside of the entrance to the cave, to the living area of the cave. And above it in the entryway was another niche. So it had apparently been in that niche when the place was abandoned. So outside, beyond the entrance into this central courtyard, there were a number of other established small room areas. The one of particular interest is enclosure number six that you can see numbered up there. That was told to us that this was the place where the father of the family, Khalil al-Khaki, did his business. So it was kind of his outdoor office for business. We laid out our excavation areas, and you can see them plotted in various double lines there across with the little flags on an attempt to kind of see, dig down and see what the stratigraphy, what we were going to find as we dug down through these various floor levels. In chambers E, we found very little. Aside from the mangers for the animals that were on the back wall and fragments of some bone and other small finds, there was very little other furnishings or anything. And the same was true in the adjunct cave F in the back, where apparently they just had stored grain or something, because there was little or nothing nothing there. However, in chamber A, there were lots of stuff, and this is where the our work was greatly concentrated, and we took advantage of this and excavated that whole area completely down to bedrock. We found that there were maybe two or three layers of flooring, and then The rest of it was roof fall and materials that had been left after the abandonment of the site in the late 1940s. Most prominent in this collection of stuff were these series of bins or cupboards. These are known as habia, or in plural, hawabi in Arabic. And these were used for grain storage. They were cupboards that were used for grain storage. And you can see in the reconstructed group down next to me here, the holes in the bottom, they'd put the stuff in the top and they'd draw the grain out of, the grain could be drawn out of the bottom. Usually plugged, we were told, with, you know, with cloth or rags. That would be the way that, they didn't have corks that they put in there. Just plug them up with a grain stopper. A rare example of this, these habias was found in a living cave still being used in the 1970s at a site north of Jerusalem called El Jeeb, where an elderly widow was still living and still using the cave and still had the stuff with, you know, she, in the old traditional way, she was still using all of these types of materials while her younger family lived in a house nearby. So, you know, you have this transition that was going on. In chamber A, there was also, along the back wall, a series of bench-like structures also made out of mud and straw, which we came to understand were called mitwa. The plural would be mitwe. So we didn't quite understand what this was all about. So further investigation discovered that what they were used for. There's also out in front of it, as you can see, a kind of a plaster and mud platform surrounded by stones, making a kind of a, yes, you guessed it, a bed. So this was the sleeping platform that was used in there. So what are these mitwe? Well, we also could see them in use in the cave in El Jeeb. This is where the bedding was put. This is where the daily bedding would be taken up and put away into these structures. You can see the gentleman in the picture in front of the mitwe there. He's sitting on the bed. So you can get an idea of how that was actually used in a life situation. Well, the habia and the mitwe have been largely replaced, you know, even by the 70s with grain sacks and modern shelving. There still were a lot of mud and straw stuff in all the village settings that we visited. These included these large walk-in ovens called taboons, in which the villagers would share using, you know, kind of like a community bakery area. And then there were lots of other structures, dovecotes, beehives, and of course these arisha located on the roofs of the buildings. And then a lot of other smaller pens and other small structures that using the mud and straw techniques. Our excavations in chamber A showed several phases of preparation and surface use. As I suggested, the last one of these seems to date from the mid to late 1940s, just before the site went out of use. This was it was covered over with mud and plaster and roof fall, and there were all kinds of artifacts found in this debris, reflecting this occupation, this use in the period, you know, during World War II, I guess we would think of it as. And of course, we found the usual kind of collection, which we're so used to at archaeological sites, of ceramics, small fragments of pottery and broken pieces there. But in addition to this, there were cataloged by the excavating team numerous cloth and wicker types of materials. a large number of leather items, including a whole raft of different shoes, and then this one bladder bag, which you can see here in the lower picture, was a common device used as a churn within Bedouin and village Arab culture. So they put the milk in that and churn it, and they let it rock, like rocking the baby. Very interesting device. There are also remains of what we call the rubber basket, or a gufa. Yeah, I love that term. When we did our first archaeological work, Ed was suggesting at Shechem, we carried rocks and stones in these gufa buckets. So we knew, we hired the little kids, and they were the gufa boys. So we had a lot of fun with it. But they're made out of old rubber tires. And then you can see some of the fragments. You know, so it is a 20th century phenomena, but it was a repurposed, you know, old tires. They found a use for that. And those continued to be a prime a construction device up well after the mid-century and on. In 1970, we began to shift over to plastic buckets. But before that, we all did our archaeological work with, and I'm not sure they don't still do that in Jordan in some places. You know, there's still a lot of places where that's still a factor. There were also a lot of tin cans, as you would expect, wire, metal items of various kinds, and then a lot of other miscellaneous stuff, including horseshoes, you can see here, embroidered cloth, and metal tools. A particularly interesting group of metal tools was found on the floor just inside of the entryway. This included several iron plow points, a World War I artillery shell, and a pair of heavy-duty metal shears. So various members of the staff jumped to the conclusion that what we had here was turning swords into plowshares. It took a little while, but more sober thinking began to realize that that was probably not the case, noting that there also were a metal fork for pitchfork, an axe, an adze, a pruning hook, all agricultural tools, more normally what you would expect in an agrarian agricultural place. I don't know if we dissuaded all the people about the other thing or not, but in any case, we did learn later that the Elkaki family had this enterprise of repairing and building plows, so the plowshares were naturally going to be there. And then we also found out that it was common to use these shell casings for coffee grinders, you know, an improvised coffee grinder. And a little bit less elaborate than the fancy ones that will be used in Bedouin ceremonies where they have the whole thing. What's interesting about this device is that it is used as a kind of a drum. So in the camps of the Bedouin out in the area, and we saw this at Gezer when the Bedouin were camped, and we'd hear in the afternoon, you'd hear this rhythmic pounding, thump, 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 pounding. And we didn't know what it was at first, but we realized later that what they were doing was they're grinding the coffee beans. And the noises, and it was all done with the rhythmic, you know, a rhythmic routine. They were grinding the coffee beans, and that was alerting everybody around that you're making coffee. And so it was the first step in drawing people into a social interaction in the afternoon. So these were, you know, kind of a multifunction type of thing. I'm really tempted to tell a story. I'll probably diverge over my time, but one of our good colleagues is an Israeli archaeologist named Yigal Shiloh, and he loved to tell stories. So this is his favorite story. He said, tells a story about the old Bedouin man when the new railroad was coming in, who couldn't figure out what these two iron rods were doing lying on the ground. And he got on, and he was standing on it on his camel, and here comes the train. And he got knocked off his camel, broke his leg, ended up in the hospital. So he gets back to his tent, and meanwhile, his wife had been shopping, and she came with a new tea kettle. And so here's this tea kettle with, well, I missed one point on the thing. He heard the train going woo, 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 woo down the tracks, and they did. Anyway, so here she comes with this new tea kettle, and they're going to have coffee. So she puts it on the fire, and of course, it's a whistling tea kettle. And so he hears that whistle, and he gets up, and he grabs his crutch, and he bashes it into the ground. And she said, "What's the matter with you?" He said, "You've got to get these things when they're little." Anyway, couldn't resist telling that story. Okay, let's see. Where do we end up here? All right. In addition to the excavation and digging up this kind of garbology, I suppose, which is in good favor here in Tucson, we also, there was a lot of interviews that were done, both with the various shopkeepers in the area who had some memory about the site. The Bedouin encampments would be visited, and then we went, of course, trips to the Bedouin Museum in Beersheba, which is always an interesting thing. And then there were some on-site visits with the Bedouin sheikhs, the two Bedouin sheikhs still in the area. There were two tribes that were still, and two sheikhs who were still very much present at the time that we were there. The total group numbered maybe 15,000, and these are just estimates because there was very difficult getting all the total numbering of these groups. Sheikh Mohammed Frijat, seen here with Dodik Shoshani, was the leader of one half of this group of Ramadin. And Dodik, who was an Arab language savant, he traveled with Karen and doing the interviews and was very helpful in that regard because he was this he was the middleman. He did a lot of deals with the Bedouin for the kibbutz, and then ultimately he became somebody working for the government to try to help make deals with the Bedouin about settling in different parts of the land. Anyway, he knew about 18, I think, different dialects of Arabic that he could pull out when he needed to. The second person was Sheikh Sirhan Zargana. He's seen here with Karen Seger and with his son. Now, I want you to look carefully, look at his face and look at his son's face. And of course, Karen, fair-haired, Danish blonde, very light. Okay. Now here you see Sheikh Sirhan with his erstwhile wife, Patty O'Connor. Patty traveled with Karen and was the chauffeur for Sirhan as they traveled around and for Dodik. And Sirhan was really taken with her. He thought that she was something else. She could take photographs, she could drive. Oh boy, he was kind of like smitten. And he actually offered us a dozen sheep and two camels to the day for her hand in marriage. We never knew if he was serious or not, but either. But the picture is pretty bad because he didn't want to have a picture taken that would make him look dark. So he wouldn't let any flash cameras be used. He didn't want a flash camera because that would show up his darkness. And he'd seen the picture of him and his son. He didn't like it at all because he looked too dark. So he was kind of a, he's kind of a popinjay kind of a person, you know, so he was very proud of himself, and he just didn't have, but this was we had a lot of fun with this business with her. In any case, both of these sheikhs, along with the number of merchants in the Hebron area that had, from the early 20th century, 1917, after the First World War, had been trading in the area, were still alive in the 70s, and we were able to interview them. They lived up in the Hebron area. And one of these primary informants was Ibrahim Khalil al-Kaki, the son of Khalil, who had been born at the site at Qawfi and had lived and grown up there. And he was, in the 1970s, he was a merchant, had a shop up in the Hebron, fringes of the Hebron area. So from him, we learned a great deal. We learned that Khalil, along with his two brothers, Khalil, his father, and two brothers, and their families had all lived in this cave complex. It sounds like a mess, but that was an extended family sharing, you know, the spaces and making it work. As previously mentioned, he was confirming that his father had been a carpenter and was specialized in making and repairing plow points. The Al-Kakis came, according to him, to Qawfi in 1932 and claimed to have found Complex A with the mitwa and the habia already in place, some of them at least. And Ibrahim said that an Egyptian family named Khadur had been living there previously and that they had ancestry going back to the 1830s. They'd come from Egypt along with Ibrahim Pasha, who had made a number of sorties with his armies up through these areas. So, this we learned a lot from this guy about what was going on. The two brothers, we found out, were sharecroppers. They also took care of some of the Frijat family's animals, particularly their cattle, and then they got to use these cattle as beasts of burden for doing the threshing of the wheat, for doing plowing. So in their agricultural pursuits, they were able to use the Bedouin animals, and then they took care of the Bedouin animals for the Bedouin while they moved about. And so it was this kind of relationship. And he also understood that they also took care of some of the sheep of the Frijat family. There were some of them that they also cared for. And we learned from the sheikhs that the cattle and a camel had been stabled in the stable area in the caves in that complex. So analysis, and these are some sheep. The fatty-tailed sheep are really an interesting animal. They have this huge plumage at the back of them. So we almost always get a picture of their butts because they're always clustered like this. Get a good picture. We did collect some bones. These were collected from virtually all of the areas, and these corroborate something of the interview data about the animals. There were some 475 bone fragments that were collected from the cave chambers and the courtyard areas. These were cleaned and analyzed to type and so forth on site, and then the data was brought back to the Smithsonian Institute in Washington and analyzed by the two people who had been in the field doing the cleaning and so forth. Melinda Zeter, who was based at the Smithsonian, she still is in the anthropology department there, and Susie Arter, who works at the Natural History Museum in San Diego. And these two were able to identify about half the sample, some 250 items, to the type of animal, the species and family that they belong to, and then the rest of the bones, the other half, they sorted between large mammal and small mammal. So they got a pretty good reading on what these remains represented. So the statistics, as we would expect, most of us who have been in this field for a little while, most of it's sheep and goat, most of it's caprid. So 70% of the bones represented were from the sheep and the goat populations. In addition to this, another 12% represented cattle. Then you have donkey and camel, each making up 1%, as did dog, rabbit, and turtle. Okay. The other 14% actually belongs to birds. So chicken and pheasant would be present. And of course, this would be these will be garden crops that the families would be using, the dovecotes, of course, and then chickens, pretty standard, running around in the courtyards of most Arab villages that we know of. So that this makes for an interesting corroboration of the kind of life and the food that they were eating. There was another kind of analysis they did. They examined all of first of all, they noted that all of the mammal limbs were basically from limb bones. It's redundant, isn't it? All of the sheep and goat bones and cattle were mostly limb bones, which suggests that they were not doing their own slaughtering. They were getting bits of meat from the Bedouin as compensation for their services. So that kind of exchange seems to have been verified that, again, these things go together. There's also, they said that the focal range on all of this was for the sheep and goat was 2 to 20 months. This is a normal culling strategy among agriculturalists. The older animals, which would be used as, you know, as searing stock, you know, for the next generations, don't get killed off. They are kept and used as mamas and the papas going forward. But up to 20 months, that's the prime time for the slaughtering of animals that are going to be used for food. So this all goes together to suggest the ethnographic data, the archaeological data, gives us the same story. Together, these factors all argue against there being the ownership of the flocks and so forth by the Yalkakis, and suggest that they indeed were doing their own, they were doing the work for the Bedouin and being compensated by the Bedouin in the exchange system. So Sheikh Mohammed Frijat was very adamant, saying that the Khuwaifi had been his group's home camp before 1948. He also lamented that in 1948, after the establishment of the State of Israel, that a rival tribe, the Hazael tribe, had turned them in and had convinced the Israeli government that they wouldn't be loyal to the new state. And so they got pushed across the border into Jordan. And before this time, of course, their territory spread across this whole southern area anyway. So they simply were eliminated from southern Israel at that time. Subsequently, after the Six-Day War, they were able to return. When the borders went down, with the West Bank, they were able to come back and visit their cemetery sites that were actually on the end of the mound here, as you can see where it's indicated. And again, to be fairly fluid in roaming through the area. Again, remember that with the State of Israel, the land was all held then by the State of Israel. So they got their permissions to be able to utilize the land under certain conditions. And it's at this time, of course, that basically in the 70s we come into the picture and are able to have then the interaction with them. So today, while some of the Tiaha Bedouin still live in the traditional style, you know, with their camps and herding their flocks and using the wells, many have traded it off for land rights, their claims for new confirmed land rights, and they're settling in these encampment areas that are sort of halfway between being a real city and, you know, being, but they're permanently there. They live there permanently. These are permanent settlement sites. There's one at El Akia, which is just south of Lahav, a few kilometers, that has about, it's all an estimate, but we're thinking perhaps that there was as many as 300, 400 people that occupied that particular place. And we know that some of the Frijat ancestors of the Frijat family still live there and live there till to this day. And then there's another huge site, which is to the southwest of Lahav, where named Rahat, where something over 3,000 of these Bedouin have settled in and taken residence, permanent residence, and a land that they have been granted by the government. So there's a shifting of folkways that has been going on through these past decades and on to the present time. Now, some early explorers thought that the cave dwellings were simply hideouts or hermitages, and there's a lot of literature, especially from the early 20th century, where and before even, where ethnographers have tried to argue that these were just the hideouts for brigands that were running away from civilized society. But we know from our recent excavations and studies that these were used by bona fide villagers, Arab villagers, as they served as the clients of the Bedouin who lived in the surrounding area. So after we finished our excavations, which in the late 1970s, the Joel Lone Center did a full reconstruction of this cave that we had worked in and put it back into a semblance of the way it probably was when it was being used. And the drawing at the top is a kind of a drawing by one of our staff members indicating, you know, the same features, some of the same features that you can see. And of course, they drew in some other things from the ethnographic remains around bowls and vessels and grinding implements that we know were used and in this area. So this was part of the museum program of the kibbutz and of the Joel Lone Center at that time. And it was pretty vital up through the decades till the turn of the century. But as we noted at the start of the talk, the center facilities have now been converted by the regional council into a facility for more direct support of the Bedouin themselves, the Bedouin children, as a high school. And so these remains, sadly, are now again lying moribund. So this is the sad part of the passage of time. Anyway, the latter-day residents of the area have now also moved on. But it is really our hope that the soon-to-appear publication of this material will document something of the interesting early 20th century era in this region of southern Israel, and of these associations and cultural adaptations that take place between the Bedouin and the village Arabs in these peripheral areas. We also hope that it might prove, that is, the volume might prove as a helpful memoir about this very rapidly passing way of ancient life, of actually modern ancient life, if you will. So, thank you.